The title of today's lecture is Networked Participation and Collective Intelligence. Now, this lecture builds on the lecture that we did last week, obviously, and we are expanding on the kind of parameters for the emergent media paradigm that we mapped last week. We are trying to understand the affordances of this new paradigm. We're trying to understand how the role of the audience is dramatically changed with the arrival of the internet and with the appearance of emergent media. And we're trying to understand phenomena such as collective intelligence, which appear only with the arrival of the internet and which dramatically reshape the media landscape and dramatically reshape how we think of ourselves as audiences and as participants in the media process. All right, so what we're going to do today in this lecture is first we'll do a rewind, trying to reconnect with some of the concepts that we discussed in previous weeks. After that, we'll go into a discussion of networks, and we'll try and understand a little bit better how the network paradigm works, how the role of the audience is reshaped, what are the implications here, what are the affordances of this new medium. After that, we'll start mapping collective intelligence as a process, and we will finally end up with this notion of fake news, the notion of authoritative sources of information, and how this notion, which is a legacy notion, it comes from broadcast media, how it is dramatically problematized by the emergence of the internet and by the arrival of the internet paradigm as a result. All right, so let's get going. Let's start with the rewind, and our departure point is, of course, McLuhan's dictum, the medium is the message. And just as a reminder for everyone, McLuhan defined and answered the question of what is media by defining media as the extensions of ourselves, right? So the personal and social consequences of any medium, that is, of any extension of ourselves, result from the new scale that is introduced into our affairs. So in this one very brief statement, we managed to identify quite a lot of important observations. So first, we have this notion of media as extensions of ourselves, which, if you recall, we discussed in the context of the question, what is media, but also we tried to represent as an equation, and the obvious result of representing this as an equation is that if media are extensions of ourselves, we automatically also become extensions of media. If you recall, we started last week's lecture in this way. So the second observation here is that any medium, any extension of ourselves has personal and social consequences. And these consequences can be observed, right? Which means, to put it even more plainly, that they can be measured, right? They can be understood as something caused by the arrival, the emergence of this new medium. And even more importantly, each new medium has its own scale, its own scale of affordances, which is imposed on reality and reshapes reality in one way or another. So the consequences of any new medium in effect resulting from that new scale. And so far, so good. This is sort of obvious when you think about it on the face of it, but the really important implication here is that a change in the medium is always a change in scale. So any minor variation in media, any minor variation in how media is performed, in their affordances, automatically results in a new scale of affairs. In effect, automatically results in reshaping of reality, which can be observed and measured if we look for it, right? So this is a really important realization, and that's how we started our entire adventure in the realm of understanding media, and more importantly, understanding emergent media as a phenomenon. So we have a medium, is any extension of ourselves, a message in this context, and this is again McLuhan's definition, a message is the change of scale or a pace or patterns of behavior. So a change in the patterns of behavior of a certain subset of people or in the entire humanity for that matter is an immediate indication that there is a new medium in place. And a change in medium is always a change in scale. All right, so we have on top of that, we have this phenomenon that we started engaging with already a few weeks ago, the phenomenon of convergence as defined by media theorist Henry Jenkins. And he identified two very important vectors of development, which are really relevant for our purposes in this lecture. So the first one is this, the shift from analog to digital, which pretty much could be redescribed as freeing a shift which frees content from being tied to specific analog channels, frees information as an effect from being tied to specific analog channels. And the result of this shift is a flow of content across platforms, right? All right. The second observation here when it comes to convergence is that we have a shift from passive consumers to active participants. The role of audiences changes dramatically. And this shift, this change in patterns of behavior, this change in scale, right? And again, I'm recalling here McLuhan's dictum from earlier, is on the one hand, obviously an indication that we have a new medium, but also on the other hand, it points out to us that we have to understand ourselves as users of media and as audiences in a completely new role. We need to first map the extent of this role. We need to understand what the parameters of this new role are, because we are not passive consumers anymore, right? We're active participants in one way or another, for good or bad, right? So one of the first things that Jenkins identifies, and we started mapping this already over the past two lectures, is that media sort of stops being as product, acting as a product. And this is, of course, this is an ongoing process. This is not a one-off that suddenly has happened. There's quite a lot of media which is packaged continuously as a closed product still, unfortunately. But to a large extent, and in many cases, media starts appearing as conversation rather than as a closed product. And this is what's really interesting for us here, right? The shift from media as product to media as conversation. We also talked about this phenomenon of one-to-many versus many-to-many, and we'll return to this in the lecture today. A many-to-many process stands for a process which has many originators, many participants which are performing the process, and many targets. So it's the target users of that information transmission of the entire process of communication are also many, right? So hence many-to-many. Of ideation, production, distribution, and sales with low risk of failure and no filter for participation. We talked about this as one of the essential features of the emergent media paradigm. And the reason for that is the appearance of this decentralized network communication infrastructure, the internet, in other words, and the affordances which it brings to the table, which is decentralized mass participation and interaction, right? We talked about this in the previous lecture, and we mapped also key definitions when it comes to the two different paradigms: the industrial paradigm, the legacy media paradigm, in other words, and the internet paradigm, emergent media paradigm, in other words. So we have mass production and a concurrent mass consumption, which work together in tandem, right? This is a key distinction of the industrial paradigm, is the emergence of the masses and mass production for the masses, right? The logic of the assembly line, and mass consumption of homogeneity of the same products. Not so online, right? Not so with the internet, because we have distributed production across the globe for many different custom niche audiences. And down the track in this cycle of lectures, we'll talk about the phenomenon of niche markets and niche audiences as emergent phenomenon of overriding importance when it comes to the internet. And this is a really clear distinction, because we have, if you recall, we talked about the pre-industrial paradigm, which was all about customization on an individual basis, right? So customization based on patronage, artisanal production, craft, right? As the dominant logic. Whereas here we have a combination, as it were, of both the pre-industrial and industrial paradigms in the context of customization, but for a mass global audience, global distributed audience. Then we have this second layer, if you will, of repetition in the industrial paradigm context, where sameness is being reproduced again and again and again, right? This is basically an essential element of the mobile assembly line logic here. Iteration is a bug. Any sort of change is a bug. It's an undesirable side effect that has to be eliminated. Whereas on the internet, you have a dramatically different situation, where iteration is a feature, right? You want as much experimentation and innovation as possible. And the entire cycle of production is built on continuous updates of whatever the object, whatever the product is. It's an open process which is being continuously updated, as opposed to a closed process of repetitive production of sameness, repetitive production of commodities. So we have a closed process versus an open process, finished product versus eternal beta. Finally, we talked about the this notion of memes that was first invented by philosopher and evolutionary biologist Richard Dawkins in The Selfish Gene, where he introduced this concept of mimetic reproduction. Mimetic reproduction, which operates by the self-replication of patterns of information from brain to brain, from mind to mind, which is built on the process of imitation. And why is this important for us? Because the internet proved a fertile ground for this specific phenomenon, for mimetic reproduction. Why did that happen? Because the internet itself is a copy machine, as we established as well, right? So these work in tandem. Mimetic reproduction has always existed. It is not limited only to humans. Ants, bees, all sorts of other insects, all sorts of other animals operate on the basis of mimetic reproduction as well. Memes spread among them as well. So memes have been with us as a species, as humans, also since our very origins. However, the appearance of the internet has dramatically changed how memes can spread, right? How information patterns can spread through replication, because for the first time ever in our history as a species, we have a media foundation, the internet, which is entirely focused on replication, right? It is itself a copy machine, right? The very protocols that allow the internet to exist, the TCP/IP protocol, built on the principle of free copying between machines, between nodes in the network. And unlike the mass-produced reproductions of the industrial paradigm, these copies are not just cheap, they are free. And the result of this this emergence of forces, or the emergence of the internet paradigm is the emergence of a completely new aesthetics as well, a new aesthetics of new type of production, which we sort of mapped in the previous lecture and we'll be encountering again today in this lecture and down the track in this cycle of lectures. All right, so without further ado, we're ready now to jump into the topic for today's lecture. And I want to open with this quote by a media theorist, Jay Rosen, which really beautifully summarizes, to my mind, our what should be our starting point, right? The changing role of audiences. So I'm going to read it aloud. The people formerly known as the audience wish to inform media people of our existence and of a shift in power that goes with the platform shift you've all heard about. Think of passengers on your ship who got a boat of their own, the writing readers, the viewers who picked up a camera, the formerly atomized listeners who, with modest effort, can connect with each other and gain the means to speak to the world as it were. So there's a lot of stuff happening here. And this is a beautiful quote because it really captures the essence. It's a beautiful insight into the essence of this process we're trying to map and understand. So we have a complete change in scale, right? To use McLuhan's definitions here, we have a complete change in scale. A new medium has appeared, and the audience is no more. We are the people formerly known as the audience, and there is a shift in power, right? Which is part and parcel of this change. We are now the writing readers, right? So we are not only passive consumers of a process which was prepackaging information as commodity for us, for our consumption, we are now active participants in the process of creation of information. Creation, distribution and flow of information, production, aggregation and curation. So the formerly atomized listeners now can connect with each other and gain the means to speak. Right, so this is really important. So let's start here. And the conceptual description here, and we will be returning to these graphs a lot down the track in the cycle of lectures. The conceptual description of where we are is perfectly captured in these different network topologies as they are known. So these are depiction of different forms of network organization. So on the left, we have this idea of a centralized network. So this is a network which is formed through the connection of all of these disparate nodes to one central node, right? That one central node acts as the hub. And if the network is to exist, all information has to pass through the hub in one way or another. And in fact, there is only one way, right? So node to hub and then to another node. So if one node wants to link to another node in this network, that link, that communication has to pass through the central hub, hence centralized network. The second, the central graph here depicts what is known as a decentralized network. And it is called that way because there's no one center anymore. There is a number of different centers in the network which act as hubs for their own smaller networks. And each hub is connected to one or more other hubs, right, to form a much more decentralized network topology, much more decentralized architecture, more decentralized pattern of organization. And finally, we have a distributed network without a single hub. A network where each and every node can act as a router for information flows, right? So if a node wants to transmit to another node, there are many possible ways for that information to flow. So notice how much more complex and how much more promising for the freedom of information the a distributed network shape is than a decentralized, let alone centralized, right? Centralized form of organization is very, very limited. Now, we are not going to spend too much time here today talking about the affordances of these topologies. We are talking about them in quite a lot of detail in my second year subject, BCN 206, Future Networks. But for our purposes now, what's important to map on top of these graphs, on these topologies and network architectures, we want to map on top of them these concepts that we're encountering in the lecture. So the notion of the gatekeeper, as we'll discuss to down the track today, maps beautifully to this idea of a centralized network. So we have a hub which acts as a gatekeeper for information flows, right? It also maps very well to the topology of broadcast media. We have one center which transmits to a number of passive nodes receiving the information. Decentralized architectures work really well as an illustration of what we're describing as networked participation in all its different potentiality. So we have, as an example, consider yourself participating across a number of different social media platforms and contributing in different ways across them. So each one of these decentralized hubs or smaller hubs could be a separate distinct social media platform to which you're contributing, and that information that you're contributing is flowing across them. And a distributed network is a very rare and a beautiful creature when you see it appear. And I'll give you a couple of examples of how a distributed, fully distributed network could be is operating in practice. And usually the effect of a distributed network operating in practice is what we describe as collective intelligence. And I'll give you examples down the track today as well of that. All right, so we have, again, returning to Jay Rosen, we have this notion of the people formerly known as the audience. And until recently, we've talked about this again, we've talked about this before, until recently, we, the audience, the passive consumers of information, were on the receiving end of a media system. That's what Jay Rosen is saying. A system that ran one way in a broadcasting pattern, with high entry fees and a few firms competing to speak very loudly while the rest of the population listened in isolation from one another. And who today are not in a situation like that at all? So again, map this to the centralized pattern of organization. We have a number of nodes who are listening in isolation from one another. They are receiving communication directly from a centralized broadcast system, be that TV channels or newspapers or radio, doesn't really matter. And they are, again, most importantly, isolated from each other, right? They are listening in isolation from one another. They are parts of a media system, a broadcast media system, which operates in one way, in a one-to-many format, as we've described it, right? So we have a one-to-many format, which is a gatekeeper format, versus a many-to-many format, which is a decentralized or fully distributed network operating in contrast to the one-to-many network, a centralized network. Okay, so now let's add another layer here to our exploration. We've established that there is a dichotomy. We've talked about this already in the previous lecture. There is a dichotomy. There is a big difference between legacy media in the broadcast pattern of communication and what we have been loosely calling emergent media. We built on top of that last week. We talked about, again, about the legacy media and the industrial media paradigm, and we talked about the emergent media paradigm, the internet paradigm. And now let's add another layer which keeps to that distinction. We could describe these two forms these two paradigms of media organization as monologic media versus dialogic media. And if you just pay attention to these descriptions, you can already deduce probably how they map to the paradigms we've already described. So monologic media is media which is organized around a monologue as a form of communication. So one source of communication speaking continuously, uninterruptedly. And dialogic media obviously is organized around a dialogue. There's a conversational element to them, right? There is some sort of equality, there's some sort of parity between the participants in the communication process, right? So monologic versus dialogic. And you can also map to that how the role of information breaks down when across these two paradigms. So we have, in a monologic setting, you have information. It's a one-way transmission. And in a dialogic paradigm, you have conversation happening. So you have two or more ways of transmission. So one-to-many versus many-to-many. In a monologic paradigm, you have dissemination as the mode of transmission. So someone is broadcasting, disseminating information to a number of passive nodes on the receiving end of that dissemination. On the other hand, you have dialogue, right? So we have some sort of exchange of information happening. One to many versus many to many. And the best possible description of the difference between these two paradigms comes from philosopher and sociologist Richard Sennett in a famous book he published in 1977. It's called The Fall of Public Man. I highly recommend it. And here in that book, he describes broadcast media in this way. You've got to be silent to be spoken to. Passivity is the logic of this technology. The mass media intensify the patterns of crowd silence, the idea of a disembodied spectator, a passive witness. So passivity is the logic of this technology. What does he mean here? And if you recall, we keep circling around this notion. I think it's really important everyone understands the not the superficial descriptions here of broadcast media, but the essential affordance that Sennett is pointing at, right? Or the essential message of this medium, to use McLuhan's dictum. And the essential message here is passivity, right? So if you want to participate in any way in a broadcast media public environment, right? The so-called public sphere generated by broadcast media, and we're talking here about all possible forms of broadcast media, you can only participate in a passive way. Yeah, because you have to be silent in order to be spoken to, right? You cannot speak back. Literally, there is no way, no other way for you to participate apart from this, right? So there are all sorts of different patterns of crowd silence involved in the broadcast media paradigm. So here you have one of them. We've encountered already this image before in our lecture on the medium is the message. Notice the when you're looking at this image, notice the atomization, notice the alienation, right? So these are people who are technically together, but actually they're individuated and separate from each other, right? They cannot participate together. They cannot speak back. They have to be passive consumers of the information flow here, right? Passive consumers of the dissemination. Or look at this image. Again, we've seen this image before, also in the lecture on the medium is the message. We have another illustration of the patterns of crowd silence, right? So everyone is now together, physically together, participating in the same transmission. So they're not reading separate, they're not consuming separate channels of information, they're consuming the same information. So there's a quantitative and qualitative difference here. And we already discussed this before, but most importantly, they are still passively consuming. There is no way for all these people to speak back. There's no way for them to communicate back in any way. There's no conversational, no dialogic mode here. This is a fully monologic mode through and through. Same in this context. And again, we've encountered this image before, right? So this is a mode of participation which allows only one way, right? It's a passive agreement, passive conformism. There is no other form of participation possible here. And same applies to where we are right now when it comes to all sorts of broadcast forms of information, all sorts of broadcast modes of communication transmission, right? So we have passive consumption, we have passive being there while not actively engaging with the information flow. So this is what Richard Sennett is pointing at. To speak in any way, right, to engage in any way with this information flow, you need to be approved from a gatekeeper, right? Because no matter how novel and how technologically sophisticated broadcast media can this mode of communication is not going to disappear. There will always be some sort of broadcast media in existence. But the thing is that you always would need a permission from a gatekeeper in order to be able to speak. And that gatekeeper can be anything from a publisher, in the case of book publishing, to any sort of mainstream media, to maybe a government censor if the government is involved, right? The government approval. There has to be a gatekeeper. Why? Because you've got to be silent in order to be spoken to in a broadcast media model, in a monologic media model. Passivity is the logic of this technology. All right. So we've mapped this. We have an idea how monologic media operates, how it looks like. Now, let's try and do the same for dialogic media. So the first realization here, remember, the internet is a river of copies. Remember the quote from Dawkins on memes and on imitation. The internet is dialogic by design. The internet is built as a network which allows nodes to broadcast to the entire network, all possible nodes. So if a computer is on the internet, a computer can broadcast potentially, conceivably, to all other nodes on that network at that time, right? So decentralized and or distributed, not centralized, right? There is no central node which approves and communication acts as a gatekeeper. Of course, there are ways to break the internet. Unfortunately, many countries have been experimenting with that, and there are ways where a government censor can, like for example, we have the case of Chinese internet censorship through the Great Firewall of China, which basically operates as a very sophisticated, centralized filter for communication online on the internet. But this is a perversion of how the internet was actually built to operate. Right? This is not its native mode of communication. The native mode of emergent media of the internet is the many-to-many format of communication. All right, so we have this we already mentioned that each individual node in the network can broadcast to the entire network. And this is a very superficial, very trivial observation. Yes, so what? But it has profound implications. And we already talked about them. Because anyone can broadcast any message. Any node, any participant on the network can initiate an information exchange, can initiate its own broadcast. And this broadcast in an ideal situation, and more often than not, is operating directly. So it can be directly accessed by others on the network, because gatekeepers are either weak or non-existent. So let's look at some examples, because this is quite abstract, quite dry. Let's look at some examples. So first example comes from 2013 from anti-government protests in Istanbul in Turkey. And so someone using their drone started recording the protest. So these protests were aimed against the government, which was trying to destroy a much beloved central park in Istanbul. It's called Taksim Gezi Park. And so we have peaceful demonstrations, which are suddenly attacked by police. And someone who not a government or media figure was recording this footage and sharing it online. So let's look at that. So you can see here the riot police approaching with water cannons, what appears to be peaceful demonstrators, and then violence ensues. The reason I'm showing you this is to make you think about a few things. First, in a country where the government has strong control over the media, you are never likely to see this sort of footage, because simply the government would not allow footage which contravenes the government's propaganda line to be shown to the public. But here you see someone, an independent actor as it were, capturing this footage with their drone and sharing it online, where it could be viewed by millions of people. Again, pointing to this realization that I established earlier, that you have, as you can see already, the police is attacking the protesters with water cannons. Again, pointing it to this realization that anyone can share content, and this has profound implications that go far beyond simple social media, you know, sharing your pictures on Instagram, right? So this can have very, very disruptive, societally, politically disruptive implications. As you can see in this example, right? Sharing proofs of police violence. So again, one to many versus many to many. When a government is fully in control of the broadcast media, and usually that's the case more or less in most countries, government has very strong influence over broadcast media or outright controls them, then only messages which are either approved by the state or not actively objected by the state would end up appearing in monologic media, right? Not so with dialogic media, because it's a many-to-many environment which allows independent actors, independent nodes, independent from the state, independent from the broadcast media model, to share information, to broadcast their own information. Here is another example. So this is from last year's Hong Kong protests. These were anti-government protests in Hong Kong that started earlier in if I'm not wrong, already in April and May. And in June, they became really mass protests, as you will see in a moment, and they were so these protests were aimed against the Hong Kong government, which was legislating for extradition treaty with China, which was extremely the treaty was extremely unpopular in Hong Kong. So let's take a look. So when you look at this footage, consider how important it is that you have an independent source of the size of these crowds, the size of these protests. And again, you have independent confirmation of police violence, clashes with protesters, what is important for us from this perspective, and again, I'm trying to abstract here from the political issues and the social issues involved. We're interested in understanding the affordances of the medium. And understanding the logic of the medium. What's important for us here is the ability of independent nodes to capture this kind of information and share it with a global audience. And these examples that I just gave you are fairly, you could say, innocuous. You could probably see fragments of them in news media, in broadcast media, in a monologic format. But the examples I'll show you now, you will never see in a broadcast form. So these examples come from the internet. So the video I'm showing you now is drone footage of the terrorist group, the Islamic State, attacking Syrian government forces during the war in Syria. And so this is drone footage captured by the terrorist group itself and shared online. And what's important for us here again is to see and understand what is happening and how profound the implications of emergent media and of the internet paradigm are in this context. Right? What kind of patterns of behavior, what changes of scale have been actually introduced into our affairs. So let's look a little bit at this footage. So you're seeing the drone following remotely an attack on a government position. So again, this footage was shared online. It was shared to LiveLeak, as you can see in the top left corner. LiveLeak is another video platform with much less censorship than YouTube. So you can find a lot of this type of footage there. So you can see the terrorist forces on the right amassing, and on the left you can see the government forces. And you can analyze this in many different ways. What's important for us is that you have the example of a terrorist organization sharing, first capturing this kind of battle footage and then sharing it online for all sorts of possible viewers to analyze. Right, and to parse and to look at from different angles. Also think of how war changes, how conflict changes, how conflict reporting changes when this kind of information starts appearing in public. What are the possible changes here? What has become possible when it comes to our understanding of this conflict and our understanding of what is actually happening on the ground? What has happened to the tools of production here, right? Until recently, if a reporter wanted, if we wanted to find out anything about the conflict there, we had to rely on a war correspondent to be there and report back for us in a monologic mode, right? So the reporter will be beaming carefully constructed messages at us and we will be on the receiving end. Not so here. Notice what is happening. That entire gatekeeper element has been circumvented, right? So we have participants in the conflict directly beaming their message at the global audience, right? And this is raw footage, or as raw as it gets. And you know, and again, I picked something which is inoffensive and it does not involve any violence, anything that you know, can be triggering in any way. But you can find all sorts of much more offensive footage online. Why is this possible, right? And this is the phenomenon of dialogic media appearing. Let's look at another example. So this example is even more fascinating, because what we saw before is direct raw footage from a drone. But here we see something else entirely. Here we see footage from a battle in southern Syria. So this is footage which came from a number of sources, and it's from battle in southern Syria in a location called Dara at the border with Jordan. And this is Syrian government forces, basically these are the tanks against jihadi rebels. And so the Syrian government and a news organization called ANA News are attaching GoPros to tanks. And so these tanks are going into battle while recording high-definition footage, which they then later would aggregate and put online. So this was happening already since 2013. And it was all sitting online until recently, when YouTube started taking down. And so far, I think most of that footage is gone. But you can still find some of it, and you can still find some of it also on LiveLeak. So we have here footage of this battle. So let's take a look and then let's analyze what is actually happening. So what happened here? On the one hand, we have footage from the tanks, and one of the tanks was destroyed. So this footage was posted online. But then we had footage which was recorded by this jihadi group here, the rebels which were operating in Daraa, who destroyed one of the tanks, right? And they put that footage online as well. And then someone found both streams, both data streams, and figured out that they're actually describing the same moment, they're capturing the same moment from two different perspectives, and combine them, and then reshare them again online, and then this footage itself found its way to Global Leaks, which shared it through their accounts, and here we are, right? So this is a very, very fascinating media artifact, right? Because it captures the essence of what we're describing here. It captures the essence of this process where you have all sorts of different actors sharing their information flows, beaming their information flows online to a potentially global audience, and then other actors, other nodes in the network looking at that footage and aggregating it and curating it and resharing it, right? So we have completely separate participants who have looked at both the footage from the tanks and the footage from the jihadi rebels and combined those two streams, right? Analyzed and combined them and then reshared them again. And this is fascinating. This is fascinating because it's unprecedented. Broadcast media doesn't behave in this way. It cannot, even if it wanted to, behave in this way. It cannot perform these roles. So this is completely new patterns of behavior emerging, new patterns of media behavior and new types of media as an effect emerging, right? And this is just one tiny example out of an ocean of possible examples that I could give you. So let's try and understand what is happening. So your message is broadcast directly. Gatekeepers are weak or non-existent. There are no gatekeepers in the up until YouTube started taking these videos down, and then people started migrating into all sorts of different platforms. Back until YouTube decided that it wants to be a TV station as opposed to an internet platform, there was no active filtering and censorship of this content, and as a result, you had the appearance of what we're trying to describe here, the appearance of fully dialogic media, people capturing footage and repurposing it continuously, analyzing it, trying to understand these events, right? Trying to understand the war in the context of the example I just gave. And this brings us to the phenomenon that we're trying to capture, the phenomenon of network participation. So this phenomenon has been described by Australian media theorist Axel Brands as producage. So this is a combination of the notion of production and the notion of usage, right? So producage. And he describes producage as a shift from dedicated individuals and teams as producers. And remember, what he talks about in terms of dedicated individuals and teams as producers, this is the industrial model of production. We already talked about this last week. So a shift from that model to a broader-based distributed generation of content by a wide community of participants. So we have a global community of participants which operates in a distributed mode because it itself is distributed across time zones and continents. And it generates and analyzes and aggregates and curates content in a distributed mode, right? Moreover, producers themselves are not locked to a singular role. So you don't have this, and again, this maps very nicely to what we talked about last week in the context of the emergent media paradigm. So producers, people participating in the emergent media paradigm, are not locked to strict roles, right? You don't have a strict role of analyst, a content analyst, or a strict role of a producer, right? Or a sound engineer. So you have fluid movement of producers between roles. They might be leaders, participants, users of content, and might be professional or amateur or anything in between. And chances are, 8 out of 10, I would say, that there will be amateurs because there's far more amateurs than professionals specializing in a certain field, right? It's just basic common sense, basic statistics, if you will. So If you recall, when we talked about the aesthetics of this new medium, right? We talked about the amateur as one of the defining characteristics of this aesthetics, and you see this captured here by Axel Brands, right? Because producers have backgrounds ranging from professional to aesthetic, but are much more likely to be amateurs. The artifacts generated by producers are no longer products in a traditional sense. And this is a beautiful encapsulation of what we've just observed when it comes to the footage, right? Because you have footage which is captured. The footage can be captured by a drone camera or captured by a GoPro or by whatever. And this footage is put online, shared, but it's not finished. It's not a finished product in any sense, right? It's not a movie or documentary or something you can get an Oscar for, or Golden Globe or whatever bullshit award they're giving each other. It's not none of this, right? It's an unfinished open process. It's continually under development. And this development, as Axel Brands describes, is evolutionary, iterative, and palimpsestic. And palimpsestic here stands for a medieval type of book, which was called a palimpsest. So it's basically a paper which has been written over, it contains text, but this text can be whitened over and rewritten many, many times. So you could have many different texts sitting on top of each other simply because they were painted over and written again because paper was expensive. But here you have the same thing. You have content which is iterative, so it can be put in all sorts of different scenarios, different contexts. It can be reused. It can be remediated, remixed, right? Think of the drone footage from Hong Kong just now that I showed you. In one context, this is documentation of political protest and police violence. But when you add, drum and bass track, though, this is just some cool footage to watch, right? It completely changes the context. But that's the point, because this is no longer a product in a traditional sense, right? This content, it can be reused. It is always already unfinished and will remain unfinished as long as the emerging media paradigm exists. It's continually under development. Producers is based on regimes of engagement, which Axel Brands describes as permissive in the context of copyright here. So they are based on merit more than ownership. They frequently employ copyright systems which acknowledge authorship and prohibit unauthorized commercial use, yet enable continuing collaboration and further content improvement. So, in this context, he's talking about the Creative Commons as a default copyright model, and we'll talk about Creative Commons down the track in this subject in the lectures to follow. Creative Commons allows us to acknowledge authorship, or you can even prohibit unauthorized use. You could prohibit commercial use of your footage, but allow people to remix and reuse your content. More often than not, though, producers is based entirely on a fully permissive mode of participation, which is you could describe in the context of memes. So think in terms of how you use content coming from Hollywood movies for memes without actually having any permission to use those frames, right? Those movie frames. So technically you're breaking copyright, right? In the legacy media paradigm. And yet there is a entire enormous culture already existing and operating fluidly under this permissive regime of engagement. So to reassess, we have distributed generation of content. We have fluid movement of producers between roles. People can be operating under one or many possible roles in the process of producing content and engagement with content. Content itself, right? So these pieces of information are no longer packaged as product, and we talked about this. They are no longer closed commodities, because they are no longer operating within the industrial paradigm. they're no longer operating within a monologic media paradigm. They are always unfinished, they're open, because it's a conversational paradigm, it's dialogic. And we have continuing collaboration, right? Content is acting as conversation. So a content might stop being popular for a while and then might reemerge. So collaboration might continue on it, right? It's never closed, it's never finished in that context. And this entire process of producing content, aggregating it, curating it, engaging with it in a producer's format is open and can be entered at any point, right? So you could enter it from the very beginning when the content is being shared online. You might be the person sharing it online, and maybe this is will be your only role. But it can be entered also at the very end, only in terms of resharing or liking it or commenting on it, right? Or adding to the content surrounding that piece of content that we're talking about. So this is an open process that can be entered at any point. And again, contrast this in a one-to-many versus many-to-many. This is the best way for you to understand the dramatic shift by contrasting between paradigms. That's how this works very easily. And here we have a great quote from Robert Cottrell, who is the editor of the browser. It's a new media platform which acts as a news aggregator. Really capturing really well this shift. So I'm going to read it in bits and pieces. So look at what he says. Think back to the days when print media ruled. Your basic unit of consumption was not the article, but the publication. You bought the publication in the hope or expectation that it would contain good writing. The publisher was the guarantor of quality. Right, so this is really important. So the publisher, the brand, the gatekeeper, that central hub in the centralized network, right, is the guarantor of quality. You act as passive participant, as passive consumer in that network because you are relying on that central gatekeeper to act as guarantor of quality. Readers today now have less of a need for publishers. One striking trend I have noticed in the past 5 years is the way in which individual articles uncouple themselves from the places where they are first published, to lead their own lives across the internet, passed from hand to hand between readers. What does this tell us? Again, I'm returning to that realization. We have content which acts as an open process, as a conversation, as opposed to content which acts as a closed commodity, right? Articles uncouple themselves from the places where they were first published. Again, when it comes to convergence, we have the example of content flowing across platforms, right? You can map this to many of the phenomena which we have already discussed. And this, the appearance of ubiquitous connectivity, of the fact that we are literally steeped in the internet, in 3G and 4G mobile data networks, and Wi-Fi networks, the fact that most households have some sort of internet connectivity, no matter how distant they might be from urban centers. There is even if most households do not have a standalone computer, they would have smartphones, which are always already on the internet. So, given ubiquitous connectivity, we have this phenomenon of trivial cost of access and production. It costs basically nothing to participate on the network. We have the phenomenon of immediacy and the phenomenon of participation. So participation in real time. And when you gather these together, when you look at these phenomena in a systematic way, you realize that the affordances of the network participation lead to the emergence of collective intelligence as a phenomenon. Collective intelligence becomes is an emergent phenomenon here, which is a function of these affordances. So let's look at collective intelligence now in practice. So again, reminder, collective intelligence appears as a phenomenon only insofar as there is a many-to-many media paradigm. So if you have a many-to-many media paradigm, if you have, in effect, what we've described as the emergent media paradigm, if you have it in place, collective intelligence becomes possible. It is in the realm of emergent possibilities. Let's frame it that way. So collective intelligence as a concept appeared first in the writings of French media philosopher Pierre Lévy. And he first used it in a 1994 book of his called Collective Intelligence, Mankind's Emerging World in Cyberspace. And so this was in the very beginning of the unfolding of the popular internet, right, the early 90s, and where he could already observe this phenomenon being possible, right? The emergence of this phenomenon became noticeable. So here is how he describes collective intelligence. It is a form of universally distributed intelligence, constantly enhanced, coordinated in real time, and resulting in the effective mobilization of skills. Now let's try and break this down into what he actually means. And after this, I'll give you two examples. So universally distributed. And again, we talked about the fact that anyone on the network can broadcast to the entire network. So as an effect, we have a distributed global network of potential participants, right? Anyone, no matter whether they're in the end of the world, literally, can participate when it comes to an event, right? Ignoring time zones, ignoring socioeconomic conditions, ignoring political borders. It's a distributed global network of potential participants. Constantly enhanced. The process which allows collective intelligence to appear is open, right? And we talked about this. This it's one of the defining characteristics of the logic of digital media production, right? It's an open process. And what this means is that it allows for continuous iteration, continuous innovation. Anyone can join in at any point, right? Because of that previous quality. Anyone can join in at any point because it's a distributed global network of potential participants. And the fact that anyone can join in at any point and participate continuously allows this collective intelligence, this emergent phenomenon to be continuously enhanced, right? It can scale up exponentially. It's a non-linear process, in effect. Coordinated in real time, because the network operates in real time, right? Information moves across the internet, across fiber networks with the speed of light. Of course, not in Australia in the NBN network, but in places where you have proper internet infrastructure, information moves basically in real time. And this allows real time coordination, fast feedback loops across the entire network. What this means in practice is that, you know, all jokes aside, groups which are globally distributed, so participants which are not physically together or in any sort of geographic proximity, they are truly globally distributed, can coordinate their actions in real time or near real time can achieve fast feedback loops, so they could perform an action, observe its effects, and modulate their behavior accordingly. This is what a feedback loop is, across the entire network, so they could act very fast and achieve this continuous enhancement that we talked about already in real time. And finally, we have this idea of the effective mobilization of skills, which is a really interesting concept, because what it indicates is that, and if you recall how Brands described this as ranging from professional to amateur, or how we described this last week as the amateur aesthetics emerging as a phenomenon. So you have real-time iterative self-selection based on expertise. So you could participate, anyone could participate in real time in this emergent collective intelligence and achieve iteration. So because of the fast feedback loops and choose on their own how and to what extent and through what means they want to participate in that phenomenon. So in that open process, right? And so this is what self-selection based on expertise stands for. Maybe you're good at analyzing information. Maybe you know a little bit about geography, the geography of this one place, or maybe you just happen to live there. And I'll give you an example in the context of collective intelligence down the track where this exact phenomenon appears. And because you live there, you can participate simply because of where you are physically right now. And this is your expertise in the entire process. Someone else may be good with sound. Someone else might be good with image edition, editing. Someone else might be good with copywriting. And you have hundreds of thousands, potentially millions of people collaborating together in real time through this process of real-time iterative self-selection based on expertise. And the result is collective intelligence. All right, now let's look at some examples. And I've chosen two examples for you guys. Both of them are really interesting. Both of them involve the same place, by the way. Both of them involve 4chan, and that's not accidental. We'll talk about this in our Discord tutorials this week. The first example is the so-called He Will Not Divide Us event. Let's call it an event, which happened between 8th and 9th of March 2017. So this was an ongoing project by Shia LaBeouf. I hope I pronounced his name correctly, the Hollywood actor. And it happened in the context of the election of Trump. And so these were art projects called He Will Not Divide Us. And for whatever reason, the community known as the internet community known as 4chan decided to engage with this art project in its own way through its emergent collective intelligence. And in the context of this, the example I'll give you now, what happened in very brief outlines, Shia LaBeouf put a flag with the He Will Not Divide Us text on it somewhere in the United States. And this was a challenge, as it were, to 4chan. And then 4chan took the challenge. Now let's look at what happened.
Mercenaries and machines, nanomachines inside their bodies, enhance and regulate their ability.
After defeat on the battlefields of New York and New Mexico, Shia headed to a new hidden location. No more chanting or interaction. This latest exhibit would just be a flag waving arrogantly in front of a camera. There were no landmarks, no scenery, no clues at all to its whereabouts. It would be impossible to find, and nothing could stop the broadcast. Checkmate. And this would allow Shia to act smug for the next 4 to 8 years. That is, unless Paul's agents could find a way to track it down. Challenge accepted. It was to be the greatest game of capture the flag ever. Paul began organizing. They set about gathering all the information they could on the local environment, trying to match up cloud, wind patterns, and ambient noise. Because it was a live stream, they could match the time at sunset to quickly discern that the flag was somewhere in the eastern time zone. That's two-thirds of the country ruled out in one move. Others began looking into intel about Shia's whereabouts, as it was highly likely that he was present for the raising of the flag itself. As time went on, distinct noises could be heard in the background, the croaking of frogs, suggesting water nearby. Then, the second big break, in the distance, just faintly, two jet streams. Paul quickly opened a live feed of all of the air traffic across the eastern seaboard, but identifying these two lines, amongst all of this, would be a challenge. Meanwhile, social media trackers found this post. At a small town diner in Tennessee, this waitress couldn't help but brag about her run-in with Shia. It was another big break. TMZ also reported that Shia had been seen fly fishing in the area. The search was closing in on Greenville, Tennessee. The hunt was moving much faster now. According to the aviation team, two more planes would soon be flying overhead. If they could be spotted on the live stream, Paul would have confirmation. Bingo. To further narrow down the search area, the aviation team started charting all of the flight paths of spotted planes, but they still needed more information, and as day turned to night, they got it. Paul's astronomy division used the constellations to narrow down the angle and rough position of the camera. With this, the flight paths, and some advanced trigonometry, the candidate area had been reduced way down. Further confirmation from weather satellites backed up the claim as an agent was dispatched to the scene. As he drew close, he started honking the horn, while viewers of the live stream gave feedback as it got louder. A few minutes later, target sighted. But he couldn't just head in during broad daylight and risk Shire's wrath. Instead, he had to wait for the cloaking night. In the meanwhile, Paul got to work devising an infiltration strategy. A few hours later, the flag came down, and a MAGA hat and shirt went up. It was a beautiful moment, and it all took place in the live stream. Paul's Central Intelligence Agency had clocked Windu Season 3 in 38 hours and 14 minutes, and poor Shire was divided for a third time. Could he ever recover? Could this be the end? Well, as I was editing this video, there has been an update. The stream has gone down and the MAGA hat has shirt with it, but intel indicates that the flag will be up again soon. A drone has flown over the area, and you can see here that Shire is keeping guard of the flagless pole. In response, Operation Eagle Eye is on standby. The drone carries a sophisticated device. You can see here a MAGA hat, Confederate flag, and bucket. To find out what will happen next, stay tuned for Season 4.
So, what we saw here is an example of all of these characteristics that Pierre Lévy described when it comes to collective intelligence. So we have a universally distributed network, right? So this were this specific "He Will Not Divide Us" campaign on 4chan was universally distributed. So it had participants from across the globe. It was constantly enhanced. By all means, you have constant iteration, continuous improvement when it comes to trying to find where this flag was. Remember, there was initially no one had any idea where in the continental United States the flag was positioned. It was coordinated in real time, so it happened over 38 hours of continuous searching. And it resulted in the effective mobilization of the skills of all of the participants. Here is another example. This is, you could say, much more serious, far more serious, far more disruptive, and with far bigger real-world implications when it comes to how the collective intelligence actually was able to affect the physical world. But the example comes from the Syrian war, and it's again involves 4chan. And so this happened in one day on the 30th of May 2016. This wasn't the only case of such 4chan involvement. As far as I know, there were three others, but I'm focusing on this one only. So it all started with a video, which, and I'm not going to show you the video, it was a video posted by jihadi rebels on the internet, on YouTube, and the video basically showed them training. And it was very simple video showing them doing all sorts of different training activities in a training camp somewhere in Syria. And you know, it captured basically in the background horizon and a few very, very distant landmarks of no immediate identifiable nature. And it was shared on YouTube. And so someone posted this footage on 4chan, on the / poll politically incorrect forum on 4chan, asking, can SG find? So can, because on the politically incorrect forum on 4chan, there was a daily thread appearing, it's called Syria General, which was dedicated to following news coming from the Syrian war front and analyzing information coming from that, again in a collective intelligence format. And so it was framed as, you know, rebel training camp in northern Hama. So the person surmised that this training camp is somewhere in northern Hama, over a vast area. So Hama is a province in Syria, over a vast area, and surmised based on the fact that this specific rebel group was operating in this region. And this message was aimed at the entire forum on 4chan, such as with the challenge, can SG find, so can you find where this training camp is based on this video? So the following ensued. So all of this is happening over slightly more than an hour. Everything that I'm showing you below. So first we have the example of these frames being analyzed. And as you can see here, user, in this case, this is a user from Sweden. As you can see here, you have a flag which identifies where the user is from. So a user from Sweden says there is a power grid visible in the video. Pick related, there are two videos of the camp. So we have, again, the beginning of the analysis. As you can see, they're looking at the power grid behind. So a user from, this is, again, the user from Sweden. Does anyone know what the height of these power grids are? I could calculate the distance from the mast to the camp with that information. Someone from the United States uploads an image. All the images I see says there is something around 150 feet, maybe 40 meters is a good guess. This is the image that this American user posted. So we have an illustration of the power grid, right? Again, remember, this is a collective intelligence operating in real time, trying to find the location of this training camp. I found this place that looks similar, still verifying. So someone is scouring over the landscape of Northern Hama on Wikimapia, which is a mapping platform similar to Google Maps, but with much more detail that anyone can use. It's called Wikimapia, literally. And so someone is analyzing the footage of the training video and juxtaposing it with images from Wikimapia. Someone analyzing again and adding more information, adding to the thread. So this, all of this happens in one thread. So people are looking continuously at each other's posts and iterating based what others have already found, right? So again, continuous iteration, continuous enhancement. That's how Pierre Levy described it. Someone posts already tentative coordinates. Someone found these five beams of a structure in the camp and found and tried and mapped them to this location here. Another take from this same angle, and again we have coordinates. Bingo, send this to Ivan, we're doing another airstrike. So what happens here is that there is while this was happening, and again, remember, this is 2016, May 2016, there was a Twitter account operating at the time called Ivan Sidorenko, which was talking directly on Twitter to the Russian Ministry of Defense, and which people from 4chan were sending information to on Twitter in public. And this looked like this. So here you have the Ivan Sidorenko account, people sending information. What's the coordinates? Got it, done, thanks. And then the Ivan Sidorenko account tweets at the Russian Ministry of Defense, location of a terrorist training camp, thanks to SG. So thanks to the Syria General threat on 4chan, strike these terrorists at these coordinates. And there were two different confirmations of the strike in the day that followed. One was on an Arabic YouTube channel, and one was On this YouTube channel here, warplanes bombarded agricultural land and basically depicted the exact coordinates that 4chan identified. And so, what does this mean to us? First, we have a very fast feedback loop. We have basically a global distributed intelligence being able to coordinate in real time and iterate with extremely fast feedback loops in order to identify a location. So we have effective mobilization of skills on a global scale, being able to identify a location from random footage. And again, this is just one example. Actually, if you dig online, you'll find there was at least three others where this collective intelligence acted in exactly the same way, leading to the identification of targets, jihadi terrorist targets in Syria. So the point I'm trying to make here, guys, with these examples is to make you understand that we have the emergence of completely new modes of participation. Heretofore unthinkable, right? So we have, and I'm giving you extreme examples in order to help you realize how new and how strange and how weird these new modes of participation are, because we have a completely new paradigm operating, right? Allowing new types of content to appear. So in the abstract, if we were to analyze this phenomenon, we have crowdsourcing in the broadest of senses appearing as a phenomenon. We have the ability for collective intelligences to generate content, to gather information, to build knowledge banks, to analyze, right, as in the example that I just gave you, and all to act as patronage networks, right? Again, collective intelligences forming up on an ad hoc basis. Also, collective intelligences could operate in a very slack participation format, where they would be just aggregating information, maybe, or resharing it. And this would be, let's say, interest-based collective intelligences, or liking or disliking something. So, new types of participation. But in all of these cases, what we're observing actually in practice is producers talking to other producers. Because the audience of producers are always other producers, people who can participate in that process continuously on their own terms. All right, so we looked at some really, really strange examples. We looked at drones, we looked at footage coming from unexpected sources. We looked at collective intelligences appearing and doing what would be completely impossible and unthinkable in a legacy media format, in a monologic media paradigm. But how do we establish source credibility? So this is the key question that always emerges when you start thinking in detail and trying to understand the emerging media paradigm. How do we establish the credibility and the authority, the authenticity of the sources that you're looking at? And when there's always a caveat to this question, that you're operating in a world, we all are, where anyone can disseminate content. We already established that. So where anyone can disseminate content, you are by default, by definition, going to be surrounded by content, and you'll be dealing with oceans of content, which is not credible, to put it politely. So how do we establish source credibility? And to reveal my hand here, there is no direct answer to this question. This is the ongoing problem of emergent media, and I call it a problem probably unfairly, because it's not a problem, it's not a bug, it's a future. It's not a problem, but it's a phenomenon which is part and parcel of this emergent dialogic media paradigm that we're trying to understand. Because anyone can create content, you would have all sorts of different types of content, often mutually exclusive, often completely at odds with each other when it comes to covering the same event. And this is a given. This is a literally axiomatic given when it comes to this new paradigm. So the way we establish source credibility has to be different. And this is, I'll give you some examples now to make you think and problematize what we notionally associate with source credibility, right? So something which has the support of authority figures, something has which is presented as an authority. So I'll give you some examples of how problematic that assumption of an established authority actually is. All right, so let's look at fake news as a phenomenon in the context of what we just discussed. And the first example I'm going to give you is from the White Helmet, since we're talking about Syria already, and I gave you a number of examples from the Syrian war, we'll stick with that. So the White Helmet, some of you might have seen the Netflix documentary, which was Oscar nominated. I'm not even sure, did it receive an Oscar or not, about this group which ostensibly on the surface is a humanitarian group trying to help in the rebel-held areas of northern Syria, help people who are suffering from attacks by the Syrian government. And so this group has been very carefully positioned in Western legacy media, in the mainstream media, as this angelic force for good. And through a very carefully constructed set of images. And if it wasn't for the internet, we would never know any better. But footage like what I'm going to show you now emerged, which completely overturned this image of the angelic group. And this is not the only footage. I'm showing you probably the most innocuous footage. This far more drastic and, I'll call it even extreme footage, which obviously I'm not going to show you in this lecture, but which you can find online of the real face of the White Helmets, the so-called humanitarian group. But let's look at what I have here. So what we have is filming of they're supposedly helping someone who is buried under wreckage from a bombardment. But as you can see, nothing is happening. They're sitting as if they're enacting a scene in a theater. And suddenly we have someone set action, and then we have the action starting. So what we had just now is an example of how if you were to watch this on evening news, you would see that short fragment where the person was, either you'll see this image or you'll see a short fragment where the person was being carried away. You will never see this full footage of how contrived and theatrical this whole basically setup was. Here is another example. So you would expect that a news station would be presenting news, its news from a conflict area in a professional way and acting as authority figures, right? Remember, we're talking about source credibility here. So here we have a Danish TV station, TV2, presenting its news bulletin from Syria with this background. And for those of you who are not gamers, let me help you out. So the background comes from Assassin's Creed, right? So this is Danish TV station TV2's idea of how Syria actually looks like. It's Assassin's Creed is illustration of the Damascus skyline. Again, source credibility. This is what we're trying to look at. Here is another example. Here we have the BBC in 2012 reporting of a supposed massacre in Hula in Syria. So in case you cannot see here, supposedly this image is believed to show the bodies of children awaiting burial. So this is what the BBC reports on their page. And if it wasn't for the internet and for all the affordances of everything we've discussed so far, we wouldn't have this. This is the photographer who actually took this image, writing in Facebook that on his page that someone is using illegally one of my images for anti-Syrian propaganda on the BBC website front page. Because this image wasn't taken in Syria, it was taken in Iraq during the invasion of Iraq by the United States and the UK government. So again, this is a clear example of how propaganda looks like. And again, I'm trying to point you at this phenomenon of source credibility and what it actually means, how it's problematized with the emergence of the internet. Here is another example. In a legacy media format, you will always see this, right? You will see a talking head, which acts as an authority figure, speaking in front of a background. And in this case, our background is some sort of demonstration. And notice how the camera is positioned in order to indicate a mass of people behind protesting against something. Of course, the reality, and here is a random person snapping this picture from their balcony and sharing it on social media, of what actually is happening, right? And this is how easy disinformation is on legacy media, and how the internet problematizes disinformation in this context, because it allows other perspectives to be shared. It allows images from the balcony to appear, right? Demonstrating the reality in this case. Here's another example, and this is kind of gruesome and grotesque example, but many of you probably have seen this picture of the little boy who drowned while trying together with his father to cross into from Turkey into Greece, cross by boat. What probably very few, if any of you have seen, is that this was the original image. The boy was found somewhere else entirely, but was moved. The body was moved to this beach because it made for a much better propaganda image. The thing is that, upset the internet, we will never see this image. Right? This image will never appear. We will never be able to see the background to the story. We will never be able to get more context to the story. Here you have another example. In this case, we have the CNN posting on their Twitter account and on their page that Nancy Sinatra is not happy that Trump will use her father's song. So this is Frank Sinatra's daughter, that not happy that Trump will use her father's song at his inauguration, to which Nancy Sinatra replies through her Twitter account, "That's not true. I never said that. Why do you lie, CNN?" And again, the reason why I'm showing you this is that we have a very strange phenomenon appearing. We live in very interesting times where two paradigms are clashing. We have the legacy media paradigm, which have alternatively called industrial media paradigm or monologic media, clashing with an emergent media paradigm. And we are observing, as it were, the disintegration of the legacy media paradigm, which demonstrates itself in many different ways, but one of these ways is this, where suddenly fact-checking is distributed globally. And all sorts of voices which were heretofore silent can suddenly speak. They can not only speak back, but also speak to each other. And this, in many respects, is the answer to the question, how do we find and establish source credibility in this new paradigm? We establish it by acting, and we establish it by being active in our new role as producers. We are, after all, the people formerly known as the audience. And this, I'm closing my lecture with this image from Occupy Wall Street. It's a beautiful demonstration of this placard. It's a beautiful demonstration of what I'm trying to convey here. It's, if not us, who? And it is only us, at the end of the day, that both on the receiving end of all sorts of fake news, but also it's only us who have the tools to establish source credibility and to maintain it online. All right, that's it from me for today. Thank you all for listening. If you have any questions, as usual, hit me up at Ted Mitu on Twitter. And thank you for hanging out until the end of this live stream. See you online.